One man, one Illinois man, suddenly as famous as Babe Ruth and Man O' War combined.
The opening kick, it goes down. Red Grange has the ball. It cuts back across the middle of the field. He's in the clear. What a way to start a game. Red Grange, Illinois, touchdown. Grange around right end. He cuts back and cuts back in the stuff. He fouls. Grange is clear. Two touchdowns already for this lad from Wheaton. Hand off to Grange. He will score again. Michigan keeps choosing to kick off. Grange keeps scoring. Red Grange around right end. He cuts back. He's clear again. He's going to score again. Red Grange, four touchdowns, 12 minutes going to the first. Touchdown number five. No football player has ever done anything like this. Grange looks for an opening around left end. He spins, keeps his balance, still on his feet.
I could play better under pressure than without pressure. It just happened that way. And I think that's the way the whole team worked. I've never played in a game, and I played 18 years of football, that was so easy that everybody did their job the way they were supposed to. And if an end was supposed to knock somebody down, he went out and knocked him down. He got up and knocked somebody else down.
Red Grange, without a question, is the most humble person that I've ever known in my life. And I knew Red Grange pretty well. I went all through school with him.
Zupke was beloved by every kid playing football in Illinois. Now, Coach Zupke, I don't think anyone could touch him to build a team up for a certain game. And I think it's my senior year in high school, and Zupke came out, this was a Champaign, and introduced himself and walked about a half a block with me, and he said, young fella, if you come to Illinois, he said, you might have a good chance to make the football team. That was enough for me.
This is play 36, formation A. It's our core play, and it depends upon execution. The play isn't the thing that counts, it's the execution. Now, we must make this play successful in order to win this game. If you run hard and carry your knees high and don't crawl and sneak around out there, you've got a good chance to win.
The players who played for Zupp revered the man, although he knew very few of their names. He called them by whatever he chose to associate with that person rather than their real names.
He liked quickness better than anything else, and of course, no place to dog it. You had to work hard and give everything you had, or you couldn't play for him.
But you know, the Dutchman picked on me for a week and a half, and finally I couldn't take it longer, and I waited for him outside the stadium, and I said, hey, Zupp, you got to let up on me. And I started crying, I can't play any harder, I can't try any harder. Remember, I'm a sophomore. And he's, Bennis, you just listen to this. As long as I'm on your back, I want to help you.
We were playing Northwestern, and they had won their previous seven games by large scores. And he decided that we could not beat them with a conventional six-man line. So he devised the five-man line, and we defeated them 6-0, and we damaged their psyche to such an extent that they lost their next two games also.
And another thing on Zupke, nobody could ever scout him because he never used the same thing two weeks in a row. Monday night football, everything was, here's what we're going to do now against Michigan this weekend. The whole setup, so scouting meant nothing to him.
he had perseverance and he had ingenuity. And people admired him for it. And tenacity, I guess, would be another attribute.
Zupp was of a different era than we have now. And he felt that good players should come and play for him because he was a great coach.
If anyone can be credited with building the Illinois Stadium, it's certainly Zupke. Back in 1923, I happened to be in school at the time. He headed committees of 25,000 people to raise a couple of $1 million.
My father donated money to the stadium when he was a student working his way through law school. He donated $100 for the stadium. Now that was a really big deal for him back in those days. And at the time they had to give $20 the 1st of January in 1922, and then after that payments for every 6 months.
No man has stood for more in the way of sports, for courage, for spirit, for fight, than Robert C. Zupke, the man who never said, it can't be done.
Zupp coached Illinois to 4 national titles, 7 Big Ten championships. I hired Zupp because before him we had 12 coaches in 22 years. That never works. In 1890, I played on the first Illini football team. Scott Williams started the whole thing. He wanted a chance to play football with his friends. In 1891, we were undefeated. In 1910, we were undefeated, untied, and unscored upon. At Illinois, our head coach didn't even believe in recruiting. You know what else? We invented homecoming.
Every principle, and mark this, please, every principle that guides us on the athletic field are the exact principles that guide us in the game of life, or your game. And you can't duck them. And there's no way you can duck them.
Illinois battling national champion Minnesota to a standoff. Bad snap. The ball rolls into the end zone. Alex Agassi recovers his second defensive touchdown of the day. The fightingest Illini I've ever seen upset the Golden Gophers.
Buddy was not only a great football player, but a great human being. Just a great person and a great competitor and a great offensive running back.
Ray was talking to us and talking about the football and what was going to happen over at Pittsburgh. Ray got kind of tired and laid back to fall asleep and put his feet up on the other bench. And Buddy took out a bunch of little these gopher matches and stuck them all around Ray's shoe and then lit it. Grabbed the newspaper and acted like he was real busy reading the newspaper, but you could see the paper just jiggling when Buddy was sitting there, and Ray Elliott woke up and Buddy burned his foot, and he was getting all over Buddy, but Buddy just sat back and kept denying it, and then Ray let him go, let him off the hook.
Here's the snap. Pitch back to Buddy Young, running to his right, met by a host of tacklers. Some nice blocks in there. He's not down yet. Nice blocking. He breaks free. Buddy Young. What a run. Buddy Young of Illinois. Say goodnight, Pittsburgh.
I credit Ray in a great part for breaking the color line. The Buddy Young saga was just perhaps one of the best ones I could give you. He was from Wendell Phillips High School in Chicago. He came down here during the war years.
The friends that he met were lifelong friends. And the experiences certainly by far enriched his life.
Buddy Young, he just loved Illinois and he loved to come back here. He loved to come back to the Midwest. From New York, and he would stay with us down the farm and get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and just go out and walk around.
I would say that the University of Illinois certainly did have a very strong impact on Buddy Young.
I went into the service in 43 and then came back for the 46 season. And when he came back, it was unbelievable. I think, if I'm not mistaken, there was 200 and some ball players reported in that fall of 46 because you not only had the men during the war that were there, but you had all these guys that came back.
We had 21 punters and 25 fullbacks, and it was just a numbers game. I don't know how Ray ever picked 40 of us to go on the first trip.
They had just signed the Big Ten Pacific Coast Conference pack for the Rose Bowl, and I don't think any of us gave much thought to it. And then as the season wore on, we beat Michigan, we beat Iowa, beat Ohio State, and then we went up and played Northwestern and won the ball game. And
we finally got it all together in the middle of the season with a Wisconsin win, And then we just rolled and rolled and rolled.
We weren't wanted. Everybody wanted Army.
Coach Ray, every practice, that was the first thing he would do, would be to read us those clippings about how we weren't wanted out there. And with his psychology and everything, it just built and built and built.
Everybody picked UCLA to beat us by 14 to 17 points.
Calling his signals again. Perry Moss shovels it over to Julie Rakovic. Rakovic to Young. Young standing down to the 10, down to the 5. He's on his feet, the 3, the 2, and he's knocked out of bounds. It's Perry Moss. Perry Moss shovels it over to Buddy Young. Young's in and over. He scores. Moss shovels it this time to Patterson. Patterson comes around to the 7 and scores a touchdown for Illinois.
There's the boot. Illinois kicks it off. It's going down the field, waiting to take it on the 5-yard line for UCLA is Cal Rossi. He is up to the 10, and he sits down on a beautiful tackle on the 12 by Billy Hoover right into Illinois.
Now, it's Moss back for the forward pass, and through the pass, and into the Patterson on the round play. Paul Patterson takes one of the teams back to the 15, got it 10, third away from the end, got it 5, and I believe he is knocked out of bounds on the 1-yard line. Paul Patterson.
Perry Moss calling his signals. Perry Moss and a quarterback sneaking to the center line. He's fired for Illinois.
Ernie Case back on the UCLA 17-yard line. Here's the kick. It's up in the air. Buddy Young is racing up to Miga. Takes it on his own 31. Starts back up the field. Gets to the 34. Goes away from one tackler. Retreats back to the 30. Goes back to his own 25. He's racing across the field. He's up to the 30. Up to the 35. Up to the 40. Up to the 45. Stays on his feet. Crossing the midfield stripe. He's down at UCLA. Pasadena on New Year's Day. Ernie Case slips a foot pass. Back to Skip Rowland. Rowland fades back to his 49 and can't get it away. Formation again. Perry Moss in the quarterback. He shovels it on across back to Buddy Young. Young gets past the 50. Goes to the 45. Stays on his feet. He's down to the 40. He's down to the 37.
In 1 year, Dyke Edelman played on the Big Ten Rose Bowl championship team. He was on a Big Ten basketball championship, and he got a silver medal in the high jump in the Olympics.
He earned letters in football and basketball and track and accumulated a total of 10 letters, which I don't think anyone's ever done.
I had a fella that played on an Illinois football team in the 30s. His name was Lowell Spurgeon. He was the captain of the team. And that tradition that I had with him then, to see him and hear the games and come up here and watch the games, it just stuck with me, and it meant so much to me all my life. And I think I still have orange blood.
Elliott punting for Minnesota and fired down the field. That's gathered in by Edelman, who feints a reverse but clams onto the ball and streaks for home just inside that long east sideline. With sensational blocking from his mates, Edelman manages to hug the border for 89 long yards to make it Illinois 20, Gophers 7. Passing Perry Moss fades back, and with one of his 7 passes completed in 7 tries, delivers to Dwight Edelman for a touchdown. With the rugged Illinois line holding the Gophers, Moss whips a long spiral that carries to the waiting arms of Art Duffelmeyer, who romps home with another Illinois score.
State goes back to throw the football deep in their own end of the field, and it's a long one way down the middle, and it's picked off by Al Borowski, who returns it up across the 20, the 25. Al Borowski, the all-time career interception leader, and the Illini are looking good.
It was a typical November day, and we started out to the football game. Illinois was going to play Michigan, and we stopped in Mahomet at one of the local churches served football dinners. And as we left the church, it was spitting a little bit of snow. By the time the football game was over, there was probably a foot of snow on the ground. It was a real blizzard.
With about 3 minutes to go, we were going into a wind snowstorm. And we went all the way down and scored the touchdown with about a minute to go. And I scored the touchdown. So naturally, that's my favorite memory.
And then I called a play action pass to the right, and I came up with the line of scrimmage, and snow was coming in our face. And I looked at the defense, and I says, I just hope I can get it to Rex Smith, because he's going to be so wide open, it's unbelievable. The ball goes snap, came back, and I made the two fakes and went back, and he was standing all alone. I just threw him the ball. It was probably one of the easiest passes I had ever thrown in my whole college career.
At the Rose Bowl, we never even saw the Rose Bowl. Rose Bowl parade went on. Festivities went on. We never saw it. Ray Elliott had a philosophy of not letting the ball players see anything.
You take a 20-year-old kid off the farm, you know, and put him in Pasadena, California. It's pretty awesome. I remember the train ride out, the stop in Albuquerque where they stopped the train and everybody got off the train and we practiced on the field next to the train. The Huntington Hotel in Pasadena. I don't remember that much about the game as I do the things that surrounded it.
There's a flanker out wide to the right. That's Johnny Karras. The end splits wide to the right. Ball comes back, and there is a feed off to the fullback. Tate is through the middle of the line, up to the 30-yard line, still on his feet, to the 20, and he's down to the 10-yard line, finally hit and dropped by Dick Horn on the Stanford.
Man in motion out to the left. There is a pitch back to Blackerus. He's up to the line of scrimmage, hit at the goal line, and over he goes for a touchdown.
Ford, Illinois, behind a balanced line. Is Kerkorian fading back with 2 seconds left to play. 1 second, he's being bottled, gets a pass away. There's McCall leaping high in the air, and the ball is intercepted by Brusky on the sideline, coming back to the 20-yard line, to the 50-yard line, hit and dropped on the stand.
I remember at the half when we were losing 7-6, and our head coach was Ray Elliott, who was probably the best coach in the country. He was really a tremendous coach, and he was also an excellent speaker. And I remember at the half, after he gave his pep talk and he showed us our mistakes and talked to us, everybody's ready to get up and go out and start the second half, he said, hey, wait a minute, just one more minute. I want to tell you guys something before you leave. And I'll never forget what he said. He said, listen, you got another half hour to play this game. He said, but you got a lifetime to remember it.
We got to hit men, and we got to hit them hard. And we got to hit them with everything we've got. Once more, behind the balance line, tight T in the backfield. Kerkorian taking the ball, fakes one handoff, and then fades back with it himself. Throws a long pass downfield. It's intercepted by Illinois, and it's Stan Wallace chasing back to the Stanford 30-yard line, to the 25, to the 20, hit and knocked out of bounds on about the 12-yard line. Sends Buckers out as the flanker. He himself in the backfield handling the ball, pitches back to his fullback Tate, who swings wide around the right side, drives over for a touchdown. Buckers, as the end splits wide, there is the ball being handed to Karras, who swings wide around the left side. He's up to the 5. He's driving. He's over behind the line of scrimmage. There is O'Connell pitching out this time to Tate. There's a sweeper on the right side. Tate cuts back over right side and drives all the way down to the 1 yard line and falls over for a touchdown. Side of the field. There is a handoff in the backfield this time. Over to Don Stevens. He's through the right side and over for a touchdown.
Bill McKay now has come out wide on the flank to the right. The ball is snapped back to Garrett. He cocks his arm back to throw the pass, and he is caught by Jim Bauman. The goal line in kick formation is Dick Horn. The ball is snapped back to him, and the punt is blocked. The punt is blocked, and there's a wild scramble for it on the 3-yard line. Don't know who blocked that punt, but I believe it was Jim Bauman. And recovering for Illinois, Tom Murphy. In the backfield as Ingles calls his signals out. There it is, snap back, and a jump pass across the line of scrimmage is complete.
I was a sophomore out of a small community in southern Illinois and came into the Rose Bowl and the first national televised TV sports event, and I was fortunate enough to pick off a pass when we were down 7-6 going into the fourth quarter, late in the third quarter, and run it back, and we thereafter romped them 40-7.
That class that started in 51, we won two Big Ten championships in the Rose Bowl in those 3 years of varsity ball.
Illinois was probably, if they rated the schools then like they rate them today, would probably have been the number one school in America for excellence in athletics. We just felt, and there was just a total confidence within the athletes and a total confidence within the student body that this was some great place, some great era.
And my dad said one time to me, after I'd visited Dole, Indiana University, and Northwestern and Southern and so forth, he said, just kind of off the top of his head, you know, I'd rather sit on the bench at my home state university than play out of state.
The national recognition, because I think Zupke and Elliott both were two of the national coaches of all times in far as football.
Coach Elliott was a motivator of men, and he had us believing, you know, in ourselves.
And those 11 bodies that are going down the field to make a tackle, and those 11 bodies come up the field to make a block, are not moving around just because of physical reflex actions. They're being put to a task by a mind. Running through your mind would be something like this: give me a big strong man, give me a fast man, give me a quick man, give me agility, give me speed. Give me something physical and I got a fine athlete. And ladies and gentlemen, nothing could be further from the truth, because the most important thing for success in athletics are mental things and not physical things.
Flashy Illinois sophomore J.C. Caroline helps the Illini trample Purdue and helps himself to enough yardage to set a new university record for yards gained. J.C. Caroline and his classmate Mickey Bates here in action, the other half of Illinois' power-packed grid duo, sparking the Fighting Illini to Big Ten triumphs. A tradition dating back to Red Grange continues as Illinois upends Michigan. Bob Mitchell, a substitute sophomore halfback, plays a major role in toppling Michigan to its first defeat. 50 yards for the Arkansas speedster that trip.
If you looked at my background, my parents died when I was a young guy. My mother died when I was 13, just entering high school. My father had been killed in an automobile accident when I was 3 years old. So I was kind of, I didn't know where, you know, didn't have anybody talking about colleges and going to further my education. But when I got to be a pretty good athlete in high school, finally got some college offers, and the University of Illinois was one of them.
And the handoff up the middle goes to Ray Nitschke. He beats the man at the line of scrimmage. Nitschke on his feet at the 25. He gets a good block there. It's a foot race. Can this linebacker beat the secondary? Ray Nitschke for Illinois. All the way for the touchdown.
Regardless of the odds now, I've got to emphasize it, please, ladies and gentlemen, regardless of what the odds may be, I'll get the job done. Tempered, if you will, only by the phrase, in a sportsmanlike way. Because we know there's no savour to the victory still gotten. We only can enjoy that we won honorably. Sportsmanship defined? Oh, very simple. Doing unto others as you'd have them do unto you. We'll be right back.
was a he was with the 59 team. He was captain of that team. Quick, only weighed about 207, but in those days the weights were a lot less than they are now.
Gary Wood kicks off for Illinois. Bob Anderson takes it. Gets back to the 16 and fumbles. Doug Wallace recovers for Illinois on the Army 16. The Illini strike like lightning. Myers fires a pass to John Counts, and the play carries 41 yards as the hometown team scores first to take a 7-0 lead over a surprised Army team. With seconds left, Miner sends up a tremendous shot that turns out to be a misguided missile. Doug Wallace intercepts to sink Army's last hope of victory, and the Fighting Illini hit the headlines by blasting the Cadets 20-14 in one of the big upsets.
And the handoff up the middle given to Bill Brown, the other half of the Brown family. He is on his feet. He breaks a tackle there. He is in the clear, just one man to beat. Bill Brown, a touchdown for Illinois in Ray Elliott's final game as head coach.
And so Ray Elliott steps down as head coach of Illinois.
In a lifetime, I think there are two or three people that that you'll meet that'll make some impact on your life. And as far as I'm concerned, any of the fellas that have played for Ray got a lot more out of it than winning and losing.
Ray was a super individual. He was a motivator. Ray was a great teacher, and he was just a very, very strong, powerful man.
You don't go around as robots. You don't do that. Everything you do in this life, you will it to be done. It comes from within you, sir.
You talk about Illinois legend and tradition. This was all wrapped up in Ray Elliott.
We're called the Fighting Illini, and we believe in it.
Regardless of what a coach says about his class, you don't know that this is a great group until they get together and play. We were really not quite that sold that they were of that ability until they did fit together to be a Big Ten champion and a Rose Bowl champion.
We had the defensive club. We were very much ball control offense at the time. We threw the ball very rarely. In fact, I remember vividly that our leading receiver that year for the season only caught 11 catches. Of course, now someone may catch 11 of them in one ball game. So we were defense and ball control. And of course, again, led by Butkus and the likes of Don Hanson, another great linebacker for Illinois. We were up 17-7, and I knew at that time that the ball game was over because they were not going to score any more points against us.
We did have a great defensive team, obviously headed by Dick Butkus and of course, Ron Hanson, and just a lot of good players with them. And Dick would be the first guy to tell you that, you need good players with you to have a good team.
Of course, the other great thing about it was the victory lap afterwards. I remember that vividly. The team ran a lap around the field because Washington was criticizing us, saying that we were fat and out of shape. And it was a warm game. It was 85 degrees at the time. And the team took a victory lap just to show the people we could have played more. And we could have.
Another newsmaker was senior fullback Jim Grabowski, who couldn't take a step on the gridiron this semester without breaking a record. He outgalloped Illinois' famed galloping ghost, Red Grange, by 807 yards for an Illinois career rushing record of 2,878 yards. He broke every Illinois and Big Ten ground-gaining record, including total yardage for one season, Big Ten total for one season, and the most rushing yardage in one game.
Coach Pete Elliott of Illinois, who guided the Illini to the Big Ten championship and a Rose Bowl victory last year, had another rugged, hard-hitting team led by All-America standout linebacker Dick Butkus.
It stems back to almost like when my parents came over, and it was this attitude, well, rather than going to somewhere where they're winning all the time, let's be a part of this and become a part and build a winner. And I think there was great cohesiveness with the players. A lot of guys came from Chicago, a lot of similar backgrounds, and we weren't afraid to work. And I'll tell you what, Pete and them people that junior year, they worked us awful hard. And I think no one, it didn't bother anybody. We had our moaning and griping periods, but we knew what happens and what comes out of work.
Well, Dick Butkus was a great football enthusiast. One of the better minds I know of. He used to come in the afternoons, maybe about 2 o'clock before practice started, and he'd set up a projector, and he'd sit there for about an hour and a half studying the opposition. And by the time the game got around, he knew the players, how they played, what they were going to do. They knew their traditions as well as anybody. And when that whistle blowed and he was ready to play, he went out there to win that game. And that's just the way he was.
And I remember early in the game, their star was a kid by the name of Sherman Lewis. They sent him down. He was about 155-pound halfback. They sent him down the middle to catch a pass. Butkus leveled him and stood over and talked to him. And it wasn't until the game was over, I asked one of our teammates, what was Dick talking about? He said to Sherman Lewis, you come this way again, and I'll knock your head off. And believe it or not, Sherman Lewis was not a factor in that game.
In the modern era was probably as great in what he did well in football, and that was to crush the opposition.
Michigan Wolverines at the Illinois 2. Back to pass, toward the end zone, deflected at the line of scrimmage and caught there by Bruce Sullivan. Sullivan at the 20, at the 30. Here's one man to beat. He beats him. He's across midfield. He's going to go all the way for the score, and Illinois leads in the game 26-21 late in the fourth quarter.
I graduated from high school in Monticello, which is just 20 miles from here, and attended the University of Illinois, so I was more fan than anything else when I came. And I learned that I had to walk a little different path, because during that particular time, a number of athletes were dropped from the program. Some very important coaches were dropped from the program also. And Illinois was set back in both football and basketball for a number of years. It affected the program all the way into the 1970s in a lot of different ways.
Have some been willing to bend the rules for their own advantage? Have the rest of us wanted to win so badly we allowed this to happen? This is not our way.
A mascot is something like an animal, a bird, something. Chief Illini Wick is a symbol of the Fighting Illini spirit and the spirit of the state of Illinois.
I wanted to play football, and Coach Elliott, God love him, was kind enough to say, we'll give you a try, come on out. And so we got out there and started popping pads. And I was fortunate that to have the opportunity to play for the University of Illinois and also portray the chief.
Standing at the 50-yard line with the alma mater, you can actually hear the intensity
that is in the crowd when they sing the alma mater, and when you see the whole balcony swaying, you know, the 76,000 people that are there, I think that you get an opportunity to really feel that spirit.
The last time I danced was in the Rose Bowl in 1947 when we beat UCLA, and it's inspiring to go down the field and to represent the Illini.
It was a lot of fun, and it was a real thrill to be out in the field and see the fans go nuts when the chief comes out.
Basically, I played when I always played in the second half.
Bob Blackman was a great innovator, especially on offense. I think people will remember not only all the games he won as coach at Illinois, but the manner in which he did it, exciting and dramatic victories, something we hadn't been used to.
Sonny Perrin takes the kickoff. He stops, he throws about a 45-yard lateral, the width of the field, a fine block by Tom Mullen. George Aramovich picks up a wall of blockers. He dips in, a good change of pace, and goes down the sideline all the way to set a new Illinois record in a 97-yard touchdown return. Now Mike Wells, a play-action pass, and he throws to Garvin Roberson.
I was part of Bob Blackman's first recruiting class, and they had some lean years prior to Blackman coming here, so the psychology was one of turning the program around to get back on the winning track.
Back to pass, thrown downfield, intercepted by Mike Gall at the 15. He cuts back at the 10, making his way up the near sideline at the 15 and at the 20-yard line. Gall still on his feet and brought down to the 23. Indiana back to pass, thrown downfield, intercepted by Mike Gall, second in career interception at Illinois, only to NCAA record holder Al Broski.
There's no question we're disappointed. We felt we had a better football team than that final record indicated. On the other hand, we think that the Fighting Illini has come a long ways on the road back towards respectability.
In my life for 4 years, and I look back on it, and I have fond memories of it. I miss a lot of guys that I played ball with, and I want to see Illinois winner. I think we paid the dues.
At the time that Gary Moeller left in 1979, Illinois had failed to win in 13 consecutive home games. The crowds were down into 30,000 area. Bankruptcy was facing the athletic department. They had to turn it around or else.
I just sense a new feeling. I'm the type of person that believes that attitude and the attitude that you create or an attitude that you're involved in goes a long, long way to success in any field. And the new president, new chancellor, new athletic director, in this particular case, a new football coach, I think you're going to see some good things happen.
We're going to work hard in the off season and just
try and turn this program around.
And in 1980, the Fighting Illini produced yet another player from that buttress Nitschke mold. Number 38, middle linebacker John Gillen.
You know what you're supposed to do? You're coming out here, then you're coming on your course. And if he sits back there, run right over him.
Winning has to become important to an Illinois football player.
There is the snap, plays down, gets it away. It's high enough, it's far enough, it's good! Tony goes back. He's got time. He's got time. Throws way down here. Smith. Williams got the ball at the 40, the 30. He's going to go all the way. The 20, the 10. Touchdown, Illinois. Hey, 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 hey.
Eason is back to throw. They chase him. He rolls to the right side. He looks. He throws. Touchdown, Illinois.
In the middle of the field. Gale's back to throw. He's in the end zone.
He's back.
Timing is key in athletics. And I just have to be one of those kind of guys that came along at the right time, and the circumstances have been right. The leadership from the university and, of course, from Neil Stoner specifically has been super. And we've found a few athletes around the country that wanted to come and play for us.
And during that one glorious season, Illinois beat every Big Ten team in the conference. Nobody had ever done that before.
First and 10 for the Illini at the 46-yard line. They already lead in the ball game 3-0. Trudeau will go long. He's got a man up there. Touchdown, Illini, Mitch Duncan. You can imagine just about everybody's coming. Here they come. Long will be sacked. Fourth and goal. Long trying to get in, he stopped.
I'm excited to get out and practice again and to see if we'll put the same preparation in this week that we put in last week. Because if we could ever bottle that formula, we'd have something.
Jack Trudeau sets the team down, looks over the defense, hands the ball to Rooks. Rooks up the middle for the touchdown. Wisconsin will fall to the Illini today.
Third and five. This pass is picked off. Edwards, they go all the way. Garsados keeps. He doesn't make it. .143 to go. Trudeau fires for the sideline. It's caught. The Illinois receiver stays in bounds. First down, Illinois. Trudeau, plenty of time. A minute 19 to go. Trudeau looking. .112 left, fourth quarter. Illini certainly in field goal range. Pitch back to Rooks. Rooks.
Once the season started rolling, it was like we were in a phase. It was like we just couldn't lose, that we knew when we walked into a game that, you know, we were going to do whatever it took to win. And I think the biggest part of it was against Michigan.
Look up. He gets away somehow from Lyles. And it's complete. David Williams. Trudeau to Rooks. Touchdown. And since that time, Michigan added another field goal. And Trudeau to Williams, wide open. He's to the 20. 10. Down. That's not a very good snap, but he hit it. Cooper, he's going to bring it out of there. He's going to get tackled for the safety. gets him down and ready. He drops back to throw. He hits David Williams over the middle, and Williams at the 30. He springs loose at the 40, and David Williams, the second leading all-time pass receiver in NCAA history, scores for the Illini, and the Gophers are next to fall to the Fighting Illini.
Trudeau, the quarterback, gives the ball to Thomas Rooks. Breaks the tackle at the line of scrimmage. Rooks on his feet. He crosses midfield. He's in the open. It's going to be another touchdown for Illinois. They're going to be the only school to beat all nine Big Ten schools in one season.
We've talked about a family. And we've talked about what we all mean to each other. And they cannot take this moment, our accomplishments, our achievements away from us.
Enough is enough. We need another Zupke.
I take this job with a great deal of satisfaction that I feel good about where we are, what we're doing. I'd like for this to be the very best athletic program in the United States. And I think it can have a great balance between academics and athletics, and one that will continue to strive for excellence. And I think that's what this university is interested in.
3 minutes and 33 seconds to go in the game. Fourth down for Illinois, and Jeff George drops back to throw it. It's into the end zone. Touchdown to Sean Wax, and the Illini have narrowed it up to 20-15.
Winning has to do with believing. There's a significant difference between wishful thinking and being a believer. When someone asks me, what do I do first? It's not set goals or have enthusiasm. It's believe in what you intend to accomplish.
Schnell rolls out to the right. He cuts upfield. He's going to keep the football. And he is hit. And the ball pops loose. And Illinois has it. And the Illini still have a chance for that miracle.
You know, when that fumble happened, and, you know, I was more excited jumping around. I think I was on the field before I realized that we recovered the ball. You know, but when we recovered the ball, we knew that we had a job to do. And Jeff stepped in the huddle. And we looked each other in the eye, and everybody looked each other in the eye and knew that the job had to be done, and we had the confidence to do it.
Jeff George drops back to throw. He finds Bellamy in the corner of the end zone. Touchdown, Illinois! And the miracle has happened in Champaign, and Mike Bellamy is being mobbed in the corner of the end zone.
Everywhere you go, you will find Illini, and there are Illini clubs in almost every major city in the country, and I think it does a lot, not only for the university, but it provides an access for the Athletic Association and a growth potential.
Neil Stoner took a dormant program at the University of Illinois and really turned it into something special. He was a great fundraiser, a great promoter. Well, we hadn't even built a building on this campus for 25 years.
I wanted it to make a statement about Illinois athletics, about our program today. We'll, on January 12th,
asked the Board of Trustees of the university to approve the appointment of John Makovic as athletic director and continuing as head football coach.
Every coach would like to think of himself as a great motivator and a brilliant strategist. But when you get down to it, a lot of it has to do with just the basic organization and administration. We spend a great deal of time with our team trying to be sure that everyone knows where he's supposed to be, the right man in the right place at the right time. And then we spend the rest of our time developing the confidence in our players that if they do what we ask them to do, they will be successful.
The Illini need two touchdowns. Jeff George back in the pocket, looking, ball in the air, and deflected, and caught by Sean Wax. He's at the 25, the 20, the 15. He's going to score. Talk about being in the right place at the right time. Illinois back in the game. Illinois driving. Time running out. George back to pass. Open in the end zone. Williams, touchdown!
We never give up. You know, as you know, last year we were down quite a bit, and we had to come back quite a bit last year. And
we became to grow as one. You know, we knew that we had the confidence and the ability to be a great team, and we just had to put it together. And, you know, Coach Makovic, he helped put that together.
Selects Jeff George, quarterback from Illinois.
And here he is. New quarterback, Indianapolis Colts, Jeff George.
Well, I found a second home in Illinois, so you know they were really good to me. The people of Illinois were great, and it was just a football community.
The lifeblood of any organization is people, quality people. And of course, in college athletics, that means recruiting. We look for the young people who have that sincere and burning desire to get a college education and play on a winning football team.
We went through some down days after Pete Elliott left, and but we came back under Mike White, and I think John Makovic is running a very fine program now, and I think the future looks up for Illinois.
When I first left Illinois, I was thinking about what I'm going to do with my life. And I think now, as the years have gone on, I think those memories mean more to me than they ever did before.
And that's real football weather. You know, sometimes we had to play in too cold a weather, but it was great fun. You know, the leaves everywhere.
It just never leaves you because it's tradition, it's love, it's enjoyment. It just becomes like big family.
Illinois football is, to me, is somewhat of an etching that has been good to me in my life, annoying and caring about people, and I like that.
Not just the ones that have gone on and played pro football, the ones you hear about, but also the guys that you played with.
When that Indian runs out, tears are going to come to my eyes, as the tears have always come to my eyes when I see the Indian. And goosebumps run up and down my spine when I hear the marching song, when I sing, stand up and sing Hail to the Orange. And that's a bond that's within me. It's a bond that's a love within me that is basically a type of love that an individual has for a family. Illinois is a part of me as my mother and father are a part of me and as my children are a part of me.
Land-Grant Act, signed by President Abraham Lincoln on July 2, 1862, made possible the growth of a new kind of higher education.
The University of Illinois has to become an even greater institution than it is. It is now, in my opinion, one of the top 10 institutions in the country.
The university is doing nothing but going up.
One day I was in Peoria and I had on an Illinois hat, and some guy walked by and said, "Oskiwawa," and it was a feeling, I think it meant, "I love Illinois."
Another thing that lives with you is the memory of the athletes with whom you were associated over the years, and to see them go on into later life and be successful.
I expect them to win every time they go out.
They're concerned for the welfare of your opponent, but do your best against them.
First time I could play varsity football, and I knew I'd be starting that game, and when we ran out onto the field, hearing the crowd, the roar of the crowd,
I like it almost better when it's empty. And I guess I like it so much that I built my office building that I can look out my window and see the stadium every day.
Sensitive tradition, Big Ten, hard hitting.
A lot of people over the last 100 years have contributed to a great program that should continue to get better.
Oskiwawa, it's a war cry.
So it's our cry to rally the troops and pour it on. It's what brings on the Fighting Illini spirit.
I don't think anyone knows exactly what Oskiwawa means, but it's a rallying cry of the Fighting Illini.
The play isn't the thing that counts, it's the execution.
We'll be right back.
stands for what we stand for, the Illinois way. No shortcuts, fair play, hard work. Never quit. This is our way.
For 100 years, Illini football teams have represented this great university in the finest fashion, and that's not going to change for the next 100 years.